Episode 136, IRONMAN Mont Tremblant with Robyn Hardage.
Welcome to the Pursuit of the Perfect Race. I'm Coach Terry Wilson, and with each episode, I bring stories of athletes to you that share their experiences at races in order for you to learn how to have your perfect race. We'll hear stories from athletes of all ages, abilities, and races of all distances. So regardless of where you fit in, there's something in it for you. Thanks for spending some time with me today. Now let the pursuit begin.
So, it was plumbers. Yeah, I mean, usually, approach to the run wasn't there.
Okay. Are you doing a lot of legs training?
I do about 2 legs a week. Usually one off the long ride and then one during the week.
Okay. Are you doing a lot of split training where you train in the morning and in the evenings?
Yeah, because I work full time, I have to do that. So I usually swim in the mornings. I'll either run at lunch. Sometimes I train 3 times a day. I'll run at lunch and I'll do a spin or bike after work.
Wow. So you must be doing some things a lot. Laundry.
Yeah.
So in your training, what kind of nutrition do you use when you're working out?
I use FTC nutrition. One of my supporters and I started using them this year after years of struggling with kind of upset stomach and trying to find something that would keep me kind of satiated through my workout. So I use their glycogen endurance, which is like a starch-based product. And that's so that just kind of, I can digest it really easily. It's all liquid. And training is a bit different because I'm not stressed and I don't have that acid in my system. So I'll eat food. I can stop at Subway for a sandwich or a training ride. I'll bring sort of other snacks. So I use kind of dates and food and stuff like that. But in a race, it's all liquid.
Okay. Yeah, going into these 2 races, man, they were so close. What workouts did you do that gave you the confidence to go into these races prepared?
To be honest, going into Lake Placid, I was not confident at all.
Even though you won your race there last year?
Yeah, last year I was coming off injury. I had been working my tail up, and I felt more confident because I had put in some more distance. This year, because of my race schedule, it was building, and I was recovering, and I didn't seem to accumulate the distance that I usually have. So, the class that I had no idea what I was going to do. I'm not happy with that race at all, but it was a hard day for everyone. After that, I was confident that I could do the distance going into Mont Tremblant. I know that, of course, you've blocked my hand, so it was just a matter of weather and how I was feeling from Placid. I didn't know how the fatigue was going to, how I was going to react to the fatigue.
Okay. You've been taking your training over the past 6 months. What was the most hours you've trained in a week, you think?
I'd say probably 20.
Well, I don't know. You're working full time.
Yeah. I mean, that's a lot. I might have only been a couple of weeks of that. I mean, usually I think I average around 15, 16. So it's not a lot compared to the women who I'm competing against, which that plays with the confidence as well.
Right. Now, were there any days where you just didn't want to train?
Oh, yeah, it happens all the time. Especially this year, I find, because I sort of peaked at the end of April for IRONMAN Texas, I had a hard time to sort of carry on the momentum for the rest of the season. And I have lots of days, that's my favorite. I have lots of days where I kind of say to you, I just don't want to do this, I want to be normal. Go shopping, or I want to just sit on the couch and watch TV. There's a lot of those days.
How do you get back?
I push myself to work out. I'm lucky that my partner also does this, so he's a good motivational source. But or I'll take the day off and I'll just restart the next day and I feel good for it.
Okay. Now, if we take a look at your training, as volume increases and intensity increases, how do you mitigate the risk of being injured?
I try to be proactive in that I go regularly for massages. I'm such therapist right now with the internet. Body and Mind in Ottawa, she's terrific. She also sorts out sort of like where I'm tight, where I need to stretch and roll and pay more attention to, so that's really important. And I also go see a chiropractor, a foundation's chiropractic in Ottawa. Between them and my self-care, which I'm not super good at, but sort of rolling, stretching, that kind of thing, I managed to stay injury-free.
Okay.
Not that good.
Thankfully. Now, if we think of the pattern, you're training in general. You're training up to 20 hours a week. percentages would you be at for those?
Harder intensity. I put that 20%. Moderate to easy is 80%. For me, it's a lot about the endurance part of the sport that we have to adapt to. And then the higher intensity, that's kind of what bumps the other bucket up a bit. But I don't do a ton of hardcore or events, mostly in the winter.
You want to hit Texas?
Yeah.
Well, so you work for the government and you have a full-time job and you also have spells and you train 20 hours a week and you're sleeping about 50 to 56 hours a week. How difficult it is balancing life, work, and training?
It's hard sometimes. I'm lucky that Craig also does the sport, so the time we spend together is on our bikes or running or we're swimming or we're traveling together. I know a lot of people don't have that. So that is a huge help in kind of establishing that balance because we're able to spend that time together when other people are getting away from the home. Or other spouse, but we're together most of the time. Work sometimes suffers just because I'm tired or my focus is off. But I think I manage it okay.
Okay. Now, with this race, it kind of shifts gears a little bit. I'm talking about the race. Did you taper the traditional 3-week taper, or did you actually? You really couldn't do that much because you just came off the Lake Placid and that was like a 4-week cycle. It was like just a recovery week, a big recovery week, and then going back into full training.
I spent about 2 weeks recovering, doing light workouts, very short, like half hour spins, 6-day runs, small swims, lots of sleeping. And then 2 weeks of, I guess, taper, which there was some intensity. There was one weekend with some distance, so we did a longer swim, but a 4.5 hour bike, and we did a 2 hour run, but that kind of peaked and then came back down. So yeah, there wasn't a lot of training going on, so just focusing on managing that start line healthy.
Mm-hmm. Now, even though it's so close, you didn't really travel until a day or two before the race.
I left Thursday after work. Not Thursday after work. Okay, so. Yeah, not too much travel, no stress. Throw the bike back in the car, take it apart. Yeah, stress free drive. Yeah,
it's just travel. So, you took an Airbnb or a hotel, what did that look like?
So, as a pro athlete, we're offered a home stay program, so we can stay with the local resident. In their home, and so we don't have to fork out the cost for accommodation, which is, it's made this year a lot more affordable for us. And we stayed with the same woman for the 70.3 in June, so we established a nice relationship with her, and it's a nice way to like meet people and see the other side of the village or whatever, wherever you are, you're not right in the center of it all. So.
Okay. Now, you've done this race before as an age group for many times, I'm assuming.
Yeah, this is my third time doing a full. I raced in 2013, 2016, and this year.
Okay. So, what's the check-in process like as a professional versus an age grouper?
So, as a professional, I don't have to wait in line, and I just kind of walk right in and sit here and doing my stuff, so it's 5 minutes versus sometimes an hour, depending on the line as an age grouper, which it definitely decreases the stress of standing on your feet or sometimes you're in the heat, and so it's definitely a perk.
Right.
Yeah.
So, are you taking your bike in the day before the race, or do you wait in the morning?
I'm actually starting in just the morning of. I may have to bring my pump, I can put my nutrition on in the morning, and then just roll my bike in and crack it and leave. So I don't have to spend any time in transition with all that stress, that like everyone's all stressed out, and I don't like being around that, so I just drop my bike and leave. And it's definitely been nice.
So with all the
just an envelope, a gel or something for just the grad for the swim. My running gear bag, I'll have my running shoes, my sunglasses, hat, and my race belt, and a little bag of nutrition, whatever I feel like. Sometimes it's gel, sometimes it's condensed hydrodurance, or glycodurance, or sometimes it's a mix of both. My morning clothes bag is just some dry clothes for after the race. Pretty simple. The less tough, the better.
Okay, so for special needs, are you able to use special needs?
I do not use special needs.
Okay. Now, for this race, did you have a certain ability when you get into the next one race?
Before I have a piece of chicken. Sweet potato and some rice. I stay away from fiber, so any vegetables or fruits I don't eat the day before, or 2 days before. And then I usually have a beer with dinner or a glass of wine and all that stuff. It's kind of unconventional, but it kind of relaxes me a bit. It's a little weird superstition.
Nice.
Yeah.
So as the time is closing in, are you going to eat anything that kind of prepare you for the next day as far as like meditation or anything like that?
No. I usually have sort of loved ones around me, and we all just have a nice dinner and chat, and sometimes I'll go for a walk, but I'm pretty good. I'll just go to bed.
Okay, what do you want to do with it?
I usually try and put something in bed by 9. It's usually a restless sleep, so as long as I'm just trying to stagger my feet or up, I'm okay with that. But yeah, 3:45 comes early.
Wow. So you've been doing Ironman for 13 years, and it seems like you still get race day nerves.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, I think if you don't get them, then the passion's gone. Yeah.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
So you wake up at 3:45. What's your race day morning ritual like before you leave where you're sitting?
Well, I'll have breakfast, which is oatmeal, or I'll have just like a 500 calorie 3-to-1. Like it's an FTC product, 3-to-1 rehab, which is carbohydrates and protein, so that would help with milk. It's depends on how much time I guess. I did the liquid breakfast. But yeah, I was fine.
Okay. Now, are you eating a shower in the morning of the race, or are you just...
No, I shower the night before, my tattoo is on or whatever, and I don't like my pee earlier than I have to, so I figure I'll get my shower in the lake or the ocean or whatever I'm doing that morning. Yeah.
Okay, so now all the way to transition, did you get much traffic?
No, not at all. A lot of people stayed on the mountain, or near the mountain, so they can either walk. There's also shuttle buses that let everyone in, so the traffic was very light. As a pro, we also got sort of a parking pass up with the closer parking lots, so we just drove right in there, which was pretty nice.
Wow, that's like super, super nice.
Yeah, there was no stress. Like, no stress at all. It took us maybe 7 minutes to get it. We were staying off the mountain.
Nice. So you get to the transition area. Walk me through the gear that you're going to be using for this race, kind of hike and all that fun stuff.
I ran a felt bag. I got it last year. And I wear, I guess, an arrow helmet. And that's kind of it. For the bike.
Also, so after you drop your bike off, get your nutrition in, and between the time that you're dropping your bike off and getting in the water, what are you doing?
Staying away from the crowds, just trying to stay calm. I do some stretching. I'll have a gel or something around 30 minutes out from the race start. And, sometimes we're lucky enough to have some of our friends come up with their RV, and they'll park near the swim entrance. So we just go and chill in the RV in the quiet, and it's pretty nice. we started to start warming up.
Okay. Now, being that this was a delayed swim start, how did it impact your nutrition plan?
I was freaking out because, you know, as an athlete, everything is to a T, so I know exactly what I'm going to eat when. And with the gap, they can delay 15 minutes at a time. So the first 15, I was like, okay, no problem. The second 15, I was like, I think I'm still okay. The third 15 minutes, because that's 45 minutes, and I started to panic a bit. I was like, I need a gel or a bar, and I didn't bring anything with me because, you know, it's very rare that this happens. So I was lucky enough to get one bag for a bar off of someone. So I ate half of it, it's about 120 calories. I still, like, I still feel like I was in a deficit, and we were given the videos that we would be going at an hour. And
we still in minutes, go at an hour, and you were 4 minutes behind.
Yeah, we're at 3 minutes.
3 minutes
behind. Yeah. So, you know, I wasn't exactly aware of this morning either, and I had already checked my running clothes bag. So it was a bit of a, it was stressful. I tried not to freak out, I guess, too much, but yeah, I did start to swim in a calorie deficit. And, yeah, not the best.
Okay, now, yeah. Were y'all ever aware of Isis's pros?
No, it was a non-wetsuit swim for us, and as a non-swimmer, that is not good news. The water wasn't cold, but once we got going, it was a colder morning, but the air temperature was colder than the water, so that's just, we had fog. Yeah.
Okay, so the gun goes up for the man. You're staying there with all the other female pros. This is like your first time still up as a, or your third time up as a pro with all the other women. What's it like there on the front line with everybody?
It's fun. Like, the girls, everyone's super nice and supportive, and usually smiling and dancing. And then, you know, when we get 30 seconds go time, as everyone has their game face on. You know, everyone for themselves, but it's been good. I've met some really nice women, and very supportive group.
Nice. And I think that goes off for the female pros, and you get out. How did your swim go?
I'm not a swimmer, so I was by myself. The first boy begins. it's not like, oh my god, I'm alone. The second was pretty hard. The swim was good, and we're like, okay, we're gonna let everyone go. And then as soon as we went, it came down again. So visibility was from boy to boy. And I stood up a few times, even just to sort of like, where am I going? And I got caught up with the age group, and I was just, it was difficult to swim, but I got it done.
Wow. So, is it difficult for you mentally to be in it, all with the age groupers?
Yeah, for sure. It's hard, and physically hard too, because they swim over you. They're obviously moving faster. They have wetsuits on. They're good swimmers. And they're usually in packs, and they'll swim right over you, so you have to deal with their weight and just the contact. And it's stressful. So I try to swim on the inside of the buoy so that I wouldn't be hit by them, but the odd guy hit me. And it's frustrating. I mean, the race organizers need to know that if female pros are not in wetsuits, we're not a Laura Brandon, like, we're going to get caught by the wetsuit swimmers. They need to give us more time to refactor it in, but it's something that they don't do, they should.
Right, I've actually heard of some races starting the female pros first, then waiting 15 minutes, starting the male pros, then waiting another 15 minutes for the age groupers.
Yeah.
And that's a clean race for everybody.
Yeah, that would be ideal. It would be fair, too. You know, in Placid, it was a women's little late pro race, and we had 15 minutes on the age groupers, and it was bliss.
15 minutes?
Yeah. So we had a first clean loop, second loop, we just went on the inside of the buoy, so it was a bit chaotic at the end, because we had to go kind of around the turn of the race, but to come out.
A little
sooner. But yeah, it, the 15 minutes was great. It worked out for the bike too. We didn't get caught. Just kind of got by all the fast dust covers. Like, so sometimes they insert them in our, insert themselves in our race. So it's frustrating.
Certain kind of goggles to get your face, or are you having a strategy of keeping your goggles on throughout the race with contact?
I wear Gucci goggles. I'm really comfortable. I've never had, what's my, I only had my goggles knocked off once. I know it was a couple years ago, but I've been quite lucky. I assume once I know people are coming around me, I'm very, I don't know, defensive, I guess, with my face. So, I don't have any strategy. I just do it for the best.
So, you get out of the squeeze. How does T1 go for you? Are there less than 4 minutes?
T1 was good. There was a bit of a run to the tent. No issues there. I should have been changed how I might have got out as fast as I could.
Okay. Now, paint the picture for me. Is this like sand, grass?
Small tablet, as they do, so I like that you walk up stairs and there's a wood bridge that you run over. It's a bird observatory in the off season. And they have red carpet on pavement all the way to the change tent, which is really nice because you're barefoot. And so there's all these pavement. The tent has a false plastic floor. So it's a bit slippery, but then you get into the big white tent and there's chairs and so you can sit down and change. And, yeah, it's pretty clean, it's nice. Your feet are dirty when you get your shoes on. And, yeah.
Okay. Now, is this a co-ed tent or is this a separate tent?
There's two separate areas. It's a big white tent. And within that white tent, there's some men's and women's area.
Because I know in Europe, it's basically all COVID. So it's different over there.
Yeah.
So you get your bike, you're not doing a flying mount or anything like that. You're just sitting here sound, you know, the bike correctly. And then you get out. Did you have a way that you wanted to attack this bike ride from a strategy point of view, or power, heart rate, cadence, anything like that?
I don't have power. I don't train with power either. So for me, it's all pursuit. Exertion. I know what I can do on this course, so I guess I was going out thinking that with a time in mind, I guess, for my splits, and I didn't do what I thought I could do, but there's no strategy. I just went out too hard. I was chasing. I had no idea what the time gap was either. You know, thinking like I'm going to go balls to the wall and try and close this like 15 minute gap. But really, it was only about 5 or 6 minutes.
Which means it has to be is what? Do they have balls?
It's not really 3 months. I think I had a 37, 38. But the first 10 to 12K of that course is went downhill. So, you get this false sense of, okay, I'm feeling good, and I need to help. There's a couple long climbs along the way, but the hard part is at the end of the loop. So you can think you're conserving and you're doing pretty good until you hit that section. But,
Okay. For this bike course, what kind of pace did you use?
I put 90 in my tires.
90. Okay. Muscle up.
I only fracked 90. I don't know. I mean, you could go on this particular course, you could go hard. Because the pavement is relatively new, the roads are clean, there's no rust patches, so you can ride a harder PSI if you want to. But no worries.
As far as the wheels that you use, are you using big wheels or yes?
I have 404s, nothing fancy.
Okay. Yeah. So, 404 front end back with 90 PSI.
Yeah.
Wow. Now, with this, did you have a certain number of calories that you want to hit per hour? Okay. So you're on the bike for roughly 5.5 hours ish, or under that, and you're trying to get 1,600 calories. So what, 280, 300 ish per hour?
Yeah.
Well, now, as far as your bike ride goes, did you want to go faster on the front end because you're still going to do it? Did your strategy kind of change along the way?
I don't think I was too smart. I should have gone just easier on the first loop. I'm controlling that, like, race horse right off the bat. It's like, I got my bike and my camera thing, and I'm going to do this. And then it got weird. So I actually got it on the second loop. I literally started the second loop, and I felt like I had a purpose. The wall or something, like I just went boom, like I had nothing, so it was just a matter of getting through the course as best I could.
So, were you executing your nutrition plan right now?
I felt it was on par. I don't know if it was the fatigue from like classes that had me, or I just wasn't there mentally. I'm not sure what happened.
Okay, so after the first 90 to 100K. Where's your headspace at? It seems like you went into a dark place.
Oh, yeah, big time. I sort of came up a bit, like people were passing me, like I was stopped, and you know, that place that you do, like how are these people doing that? Like, or you know, I think like 2 years ago I did this bike course 10 minutes faster than I did on Sunday. And so it's, you kind of like, where did I go running training? Like, what do I sense of wind today? And you know, factor in, you know, life events that have happened. And so, you know, your brain starts playing mean tricks on you. And I was just trying not to get passed by the girl behind me, basically, was my goal for that particular loop.
Okay, so how did you deal with this little bad spot of this dark hole that your mind was in? Because if you're going in there at 80 to 90K or a little bit thereafter, you still have almost 100 years ago. This isn't a short bike course, and you're not over here talking to each other by yourself.
For sure. I don't know. I guess I just kind of shut my brain off a bit. Like, you ask me what I think about it, and I don't remember. I think I was just trying to get to, you know, the turnaround, and then from the turnaround to the certain spot on the course that I knew, and just getting from spot to spot, and trying to get back to transition. It was just, I think it was just a matter of setting those short-term goals in my head.
Wow. So a lot of people actually, when they go into these dark places, they want to, they have to revert back to why they're doing it in the first place. I'm sure you can relate to that as well.
Yeah.
So why are you out there doing this?
I did ask myself that. This year I've been struggling with trying to find an answer for that, because I feel like my passion is kind of decreasing a bit for the sport. I used to love racing, and this year things have just not been going how I want them to. So that's sort of, you know, it's fun when you're doing well. It's not something when you're not doing well. And I don't know why I was so tired that day. It's still trying to figure that out.
Do you think you might have put too much pressure on yourself to perform?
Yeah, I do. Everyone that knows me, they always say that. Congrats on your race. And I'm like, well, I'm congratulating you. That was not a good performance. And so I do put a lot of pressure on myself. And that has nothing to do with being a pro. I find I have less pressure on myself being a pro. Because, you know, no one thinks that, you know, I'm going to win a race. That's not there. As an age grouper, it's like, oh, you know, you always win, so you're going to win. And, like, the pressure there is crazy. Like, and I don't know why. It's just a sport. But I had a certain time in mind, and I didn't get it. So, yeah.
So, as far as the bike ride goes, is there anything you just want to be aware of that hasn't done this bike course before?
Yes. The last 20K of each loop is incredibly challenging. So you want to be aware of that. I mean, if you're not able to train at trail level before the race, definitely drive that section. Because if you don't know what you're doing, it's going to kick in the butt.
So, how do you think
steep. There's a couple steep climbs that you need to be aware of and have the right gearing for.
Now there's a no pass on Circuit, right?
There's one on a bridge, which, you know, kudos to the race organizers for recognizing that that is an unsafe area. For me, it wasn't a big deal. I didn't have to deal with one passing anyone. You know, it's very short. The break account, right, too. You know, if you're running next kilometer an hour and you don't pass, you're only going to lose, you know, like 4 seconds. Like, what is that? Basically, I'm picking up later. And then the second no passing zone is, and that's the section I was just talking to you about. It's from a huge accident about 2 years ago, and just as a result of that, I've felt that sort of that certain downhill, and I agree with it. There are a lot of riders there that don't know how to descend, and riders that do know how to descend that are around inexperienced riders, and it just creates this easy situation. So for that 5 or 10 seconds, you can just relax and get up on your bars and just make sure everyone's safe. It's not a big deal.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know, knowing that the last 20K of each loop is the hardest part, what was your strategy? Did you want to go into a very easy gear with this, or what was that like mentally because you're using RP?
Yeah, so the first loop, I do it incredibly easy. I was in a small chamber most of the time, just spinning up legs, saving it for, you know, until the last, saving myself for the next loop. Thinking that that would be a good strategy, it turned out not to be, but, but yeah, I recommend just wear some good descents, which you can rest your legs, but, take it easy, don't blow all your joke early matches on that. It's not worth it.
Okay. Now, being that you've been like Placid, how would you compare this bike course in toughness to like Placid?
It's easier. Placid doesn't really give you a chance to get into a rhythm. You're either going fast or slow. Climbing and descending, and there's a couple flat spots, but I feel like I'm by all the tunnels. Sort of, you know, those 70k of flat-ish roads, and you can really, you're in your arrow for most of the ride. There's some longer climbs, but you can power through them. I just think it's an easier course, maybe just because I know it. But
as far as whenever you say longer climbs, are you saying 15, 20K, or you say 5K? What are you saying as far as this long climb?
I'd say it's probably about a K. And it's on a highway. It's pretty gradual. It's in between two rock faces, so it's pretty hot, but nothing crazy. I've seen guys pass me in their big chain ring, so it's not something you can actually power up if you wanted to.
As far as the aid stations here, how well is Dr. Lane? Did you have any issues in any of the aid stations? What did you get at them?
Yeah, no issues. They're well stocked with everything. Yes, water, Gatorade, so if you wanted gels, gym tubes, bananas, all that stuff. I only take water, so no issues from either. They weren't too crowded either, so that was nice.
Nice. Now, as far as the last, say, 3 miles of the bike course goes, you're coming back into town, getting back in there, or sorry, 6K of the bike ride. Are you doing any type of transition to start preparing for the run?
I'll usually spin at a higher RPM, just to get my legs kind of ready for the run. And I'll take the last time nutrition and some water. So, nothing too crazy. I just mentally prepare myself to get off my bike.
Are you doing any sliding just now where you get your feet out of your shoes?
Yeah, I do that. So I'll do that in the like, there's a little chute that you can do that in. So I do that in the slide just now. I'm comfortable to stop and get off my bike. I don't get into the accidents here.
You don't want to see that. That's nice this year. After you get off the bike, you hand it off, and you get to T2. How does T2 go for you? What does that look like?
it's carpeted because you're bare feet usually, or you're in your shoes, and you just sort of run around. The transition area back to the tent is pretty short. You grab your bag off the ground and you go into the ladies' or men's tent and have a seat.
Yeah,
we're
going to
run 42K or 26 miles.
Yeah, so as soon as you get out of tea, too, out of tea and coming out, where's your mind at?
I don't know. I think I was, I didn't know how the run was going to go, so I was just focused on seeing my partner on the side of the road and heading up. There's one steep hill right out of transition. So I knew it was coming, so I was like, I'm going to run up this one, and I knew my friends were going to be on the other side, so eventually I was really waiting to see that smile and come out of time, and kind of happy to be off my bike and see how the run was going to go.
Nice, now is your any cramping or GI issues at this point?
Not at all. There was no GI problems at all that day. I don't cramp. I don't know why, but I felt my legs felt good. I just started my little marathon shuffle. I wasn't crazy, I think excited to be up there. The volunteers and the crowd are just amazing there.
Well, now, did you have a strategy before you got the run of how you wanted to go about and go through this one for us?
Yeah, so the first five or six rolling hills, and I was just going to take it easy until I got to the flat part of the course that's a little, the shaded path, which is, it's very straight. It's kind of a slight downhill on the way out, and so I was just planning to take it easy until then and get my calories in and get some more drink, and I thought as many people as I could.
Nice. Are you using pace-based, heart rate-based, or RPM on the run? What's it looking
like? I tend not to. Like, I'll look at my watch just to kind of see where I'm at, but it's all RPE. All race day is usually RPE for me. Depends how you're feeling. I mean, it's good. I'll tell you, it's good. Your pace is a set at a time, and try and hit them, but if you're not hitting them, it's going to send you into a lot of dark spots. So, just running and seeing how I felt, and no goal in mind. I mean, roughly you kind of know what you can do in a marathon, but I don't set that as a standard. It kind of is what it is.
Okay. Now, it seems like you know your body enough to know that you have to be within yourself throughout the marathon, because setting expectations of pace or heart rate and not meeting those will lead to bad places in the run, dark spots and things like that mentally, so you avoid that.
Yeah, I do. I've never been training. I'll try any of the paces that my coach sets for me, but even then, I'm not very good at it. It's kind of, my body's doing what it can do for that day, and if I feel good, then I could probably run a 320 marathon, but if I don't feel good, it's going to be the 328, 330, or lower. So it's important for me just to stay within each kilometer and not to think too far ahead.
Okay. Now, as far as this course goes, it's a two-loop course, and you pass by the finish line once on the second loop. Before you get to that point, how was the support of the course? Because you got up there pretty early, right?
Once in a while, it's just, it's one of the most amazing courses. There's people there all day, everywhere. So you go through the old village, which is sort of my LA part, and there's people lines around the whole way. And once you get out onto this course, the volunteers are there for you, and it's just incredible. And even the other, the racers that are ahead of me, everyone's smiling and giving high fives, because everyone knows that section is lonely. And together we make it kind of fun for each other.
Nice. So, for the lonely parts, where did you get any dark spots on the run?
The first loop, I seem to be chugging along at a decent pace. But I was sort of enjoying that, being in the crochet and getting from aid station to aid station and then kind of seeing the ladies at it meeting, and it's always inspiring. It's so fast.
Yeah. So you kind of had an idea of where you were to the race?
Yeah, okay, I guess I knew I was like off the bike, and I was trying to hold on to that. So that's sort of the stubborn part of my brain, but it kept me going a little bit.
For Sherpas that are doing, or Sherpas that have athletes in this race, what advice would you want to give them that would be the best Sherpas that can be?
So, the course I feel is pretty spectator friendly. I mean, you can skip the village and see your athlete like 6, 7, 8 times, I think. But, it's important, I guess. Yeah, there's a couple hard parts at the beginning of the run, and I think. To support their athlete on those little hills, it's really appreciated. But you don't have to worry about the weather or whatever. There's lots of people out there to help them out. And, yeah.
And so, as far as looking at the ride course from your standpoint, did you see anything funny on the ride course?
I always kind of see funny things. Like, there's a lot of bodily function that's happening that make me laugh, and it's
make you laugh?
Oh, yeah. It's a little scary running outside someone in the past cast, and like, oh my god, there's no behind me, and it's just kind of like, oh, I can be a tap for a little bit. There's a lot of funny stuff, and non-funny stuff, which, you know, you see people hurting and walking, and you want to support them, and you don't know how, and, you know, it's safe. Kind of always giving people encouragement, and there's the triathlon teams, like they have too, and one in particular, energy, and they're just like this huge, like, I don't know, set organization, and they're always just like, yeah, like they're so loud, and it's just like, you guys, you just like, you feel like you live in a mansion, and all you do is triathlon 24/7, and they're just so good, and like they're so loud, and it's quite funny. But, yeah, lots of stuff goes on. It's
wishing a
video at all.
Wow. Let's
take this video. I don't know. A lot of my friends do the race, so like when I see their smiling faces, I'll say that I'm not smiling, and they go on their way to like yell at me and support me, and I just that really sticks out to me. It's just an effort that other people make to make sure that like I'm having a good race and I'm having their race, and I like all the run back at them, and it's like afterwards, I'm like, so sorry. It's just, I can't wrap my head.
Wow. Now, whatever you took into the race, did you get some red bracelets? The red bracelets you get the volunteers?
Yeah, we do every time, and I wear mine. And I think that's a great idea. I mean, I am huge on thanking volunteers. I love them to death. I love all the little kids, and it's just when I see people being rude to volunteers, I don't even know what to say or do. But I think the Red Bracelet program is like it's pretty awesome.
So did you get it?
It's a little girl at one of the aid stations. She had about 3 or 4 already on her wrist, but she was just so cute. She's French, and she was just pulling like out. Sometimes they just stick out to me, and I just get to you. And there was one lady on the course on one of the first climbs, and she said to me, "She's, you got this, sweetheart." And like, just sometimes you just need that, like, I don't know, that like mom to tell you that it's okay. And you know, on the bike course, you can't really give your bracelet to someone, and you know, it would have been her, but a little girl grabbed my heart.
So, how hard was this race for you?
I was pretty up there. The second loop of the run, you know, I did a lot of walking and crying. And the crying in triathlon, there was.
What happened?
I don't know. I feel like they gave up, and I was frustrated with myself. But I turned it around, you know, it was so many people were there supporting me, and, you know, I could do this for them, I can do it for me, I can smile. And so I kind of pulled it together, and then I got that stubborn part of me wanted that 6th place, so I did whatever it took.
Well, you know, as you're facing the final few miles of the
is true. I'll tell you about it. It's just amazing. And it will suck you right in. It doesn't matter how bad you're feeling. You will run.
Wow. So after you make the leap to go to the finish line, and not knowing your next one, how was that?
Amazing. And so when it's next to you that you're done, it's just like, wow, this is crazy. You're running through the middle of the village. It's cobblestone. So it's like, oh, I don't want to trip. But you're going downhill. You're going fast. So it's just exhilarating. Just kind of go to the light. And people are, you know, high-fiving people. It's just, it's one of the best finish lines.
Wow. So after you get to where you actually see the finish line, how does it still finish?
Pretty awesome, you know, all the bad parts kind of melt away, and you just, I don't know, your brain kind of forgets all the bad parts that happened, and you just enjoy the people welcoming you at the finish line, and my home stay host was there, so she was there to give me a big hug, which was nice, because my parents couldn't make it, and, yeah, I was relieved.
Nice, so after you cross the finish line, what did you do?
I sat down and tried to get some drink into me, but I usually struggle after an Ironman just to eat food or drink. I usually don't feel well, just, I don't know, whether it's exertion or whatever it is, the stress is gone. But, I had a nap in the grass.
Wow. So what's something you learned from this experience that you'd love to pass on to someone who hasn't done this race before?
That's a tough question, Terry. I think just don't put too much pressure on yourself. The course is beautiful, and just enjoy it. Enjoy the volunteers, the spectators, the other athletes. It's just it's a wonderful experience. So try not to let your stress and anxiety overshadow that, because you get to be there. It's beautiful.
Wow. Looking back on it, do you think you were pretty prepared for this race?
I thought I was. I was excited to do this race versus Lake Placid, but I ended up not wanting to do it. So I sort of had a bad attitude about it in the first place. But what's kind of like, because I love it, I was excited. I was telling you, I can do this. I know this course. I'm going to be happy there. I have lots of friends there that are doing it and watching. And I was still prepared for it. Yeah.
Okay. Now, if you could do the season scheduling again, would you put like Placid and Mont Tremblant on the same year?
No, I don't think I would have done like Placid. I would have just taken that out. Focus on Tremblant, and I think it could have been the difference between a good day and a bad day.
Okay.
But now I'm still learning.
Right. Now, how can IRONMAN have made your race experience as an athlete better?
That's fair to say. Well, Tremblant, they leave very little to improve. I guess maybe the smooth start, they could have had maybe something for the athletes in terms of McDonald's or drinks or something. They did start offering water at one point, but I don't know. They didn't know what was going to happen either, so it's hard to put that on them. But maybe for next time, just as a backup, have something for athletes to eat.
Okay. Now, for athletes that are doing this the first time that don't live an hour and a half away, how logistically complicated is this race, you think?
I don't think it's that complicated. There are two things you can fly into Montreal or Ottawa, which are two big cities. And the drive to Tremblant is not stressful. It's highway. It's beautiful. So I think in terms of logistics, it's not complicated to get here.
Well, we covered quite a bit about your race. Do you have anything else to add?
I don't think so.
Wow. So, that's good. What's next for you?
I quit Ironman on Saturday, so we'll see. I'm setting up for Arizona in November. My partner's also doing that one.
Nice.
in the Bay Area, that's 12 weeks away. So I was planning on a local path, but we'll see. I might skip that and just take the rest and put the focus on Arizona. Maybe I'll have a good race there.
So you've been in triathlon for nearly 30 years. You've been doing it as a pro, and you've done a lot of races. What races do remain on your bucket list?
I really want to go to Europe. You know, it would be fun to do cross. I want to do that one. I think there's a couple. I don't know, Wales, UK, the chess ones over there. Same sort of what they found too, but we'll see.
Okay. So, how do the athletes follow you?
Only follow me on Instagram. I'm not super social media, so there's a lot of triathlon and my dog on there. But I try to keep updating my daily adventures there.
Okay. Well, Robyn, I just want to thank you so much for coming on. And I only have one more question for you. And that's, what's your definition of a perfect race?
Well, it doesn't exist yet. It's a really hard race. Okay. A perfect race would be where you are smiling and loving every second of it. I've had one race like that.
Really?
Yes. 2 years ago, I was going back. It was just one of those days, and everything went right. And, I'm still searching for another one of those.
How did you go into that race? Did you go into it with expectations, or were you just kind of going into it like whatever happens, happens?
Yeah, exactly. No pressure. There was no pressure there. And I didn't build up to that race, so I was spent and uninjured. And so, just my family was there too. And,
Nice. Well, Robyn, thank you so much for spending some time with me. I enjoyed hearing about your race. I look forward to following you in the future in Arizona. I would love to have you back on in Arizona.
Yeah, no problem. I'll have better things to say about my race.
I'm sure it will be. You're so into it. I'm doing a full 4 weeks prior.
Yeah.
Well, you're really able to talk soon, okay?
Thanks for tuning in today. I hope you were able to learn something from today's episode. If you enjoy the show, please take a minute to leave a review on iTunes or share it with a friend. Be sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. If you'd like to see pictures from this athlete's race, learn more about who I am, what I'm doing, or be on the show yourself to share your story, check out my website at CoachTerryWilson.com. Until next time, continue the pursuit.